Hello friends of human spaceflight, and welcome to another week in review as we look into the space industry and notable launch activities from around the world. Coming up, Relativity Space had a date with destiny this week with the much anticipated launch debut of their Terran 1 rocket. And it's not just another rocket, this has to be seen to be believed. OneWeb continues to expand their satellite constellation. We take a look at their latest efforts and see just how close they are to their objectives. Japan also recently had their own first launch attempt of the brand new H3 launch vehicle. However, things didn't go as planned. Let's find out what happened right here on To the Future, your new home for the latest and greatest in space news. Let's get cracking! Relativity Space was at the pad on March 8th at Launch Complex 16 in Cape Canaveral, Florida, ready to give their first demonstration flight a red-hot go. The mission, dubbed Good Luck, Have Fun, was all about demonstrating their expendable two-stage small payload launch vehicle named Terran 1. There is something very unique about this rocket though, which I will cover for you in a moment. Not least of which is that the company's co-founder, Tim Ellis, used to work at Blue Origin, and now he has a rocket on the pad before they do. With that little gem, let's check out this historic launch part 2. With weather just perfect and a clear range, Terran 1 took the center stage once again, standing just short of its typical height of 115 feet and 7.5 feet wide. Height was shortened by 5 feet thanks to having a nose cone fitted and no payload fairing. The absence of a payload for this demonstration flight meant the nose cone had a special commemorative disc attached, as seen here in this post to social media. Originally printed by a first generation version of the Stargate Metal 3D printer, it was a fitting tribute highlighting the journey to this incredible moment. So, now for the big show and main engine ignition of 9 Aeon 1 engines producing some 102,309 newtons or 23,000 pounds of force at sea level. The vehicle leapt off the pad on Wednesday, March 22nd at 11:25 PM ET. It's easy to see how this much raw power is capable of delivering up to 1,250 kilograms to low Earth orbit, and all at an estimated cost of just $10 million. With the rapid ascent, we soon had the make or break moment for any launch, that of maximum aerodynamic pressure on the launch vehicle, known as Max-Q. It effortlessly punched through the invisible barrier, and it was now time to apply full throttle and go supersonic, with all systems showing nominal. This moment was just so exciting to witness. The official dawn of a new launch provider was well and truly underway. Around 3 minutes after liftoff, there was stage separation, nice and smooth. The core booster, having achieved its objective, was destined for an eventual destructive impact with the Atlantic Ocean several minutes later. The Aeon vacuum engine ignited, much to the delight of all watching. But wait, shouldn't we see a red glowing engine bell by now? Oh boy. First indication something had not gone as expected. With live telemetry data continuing to drop, it was clear they were not going to make orbit on their first attempt. But what an incredible effort it was to reach this point. And with that, the webcast came to a close a few minutes later. If this is all new information, you may be wondering about what I meant when I spoke a moment ago about 3D printing. Abandoning traditionally fixed tool production methods, we now no longer see a launch vehicle manufactured by what has been the industry standard for over 60 years. The overall benefit here is rapid design iterations and production modifications on the fly. No need to remake tools, jigs, or other plant and equipment as they use truly innovative and game-changing production techniques. One production method is called powder bed fusion, which is used to make the Aeon engines, for example. Terran 1 is currently 85% 3D printed by mass, with future production enhancements expected to raise that to 95%. Producing this amazing launch vehicle is also carried out using a custom metal 3D printer, affectionately called Stargate. It is the world's largest 3D printer of this type, using proprietary metal alloy wire and welding technologies in a process called vertical wire arc additive manufacturing. It melts the wire in layers, resulting in very few joints or individual parts to make up its structure and engines. The production site and headquarters for Terran 1, known as the Portal, is in Long Beach, California. Contained in a comparatively teeny tiny 120,000 square feet factory this time, it hosts business operations as well. It is here they anticipate producing a launch-ready Terran 1 rocket with a 10-foot payload fairing in less than 60 days. Simply incredible if you ask me. But what do you think? Can they achieve this? Let me know down below. Relativity also operate out of several other locations, including Seattle, Stennis, and a second launch site in progress on the west coast at Vandenberg Space Force Base. But wait, there's more. A new fourth generation Stargate printer is gearing up to produce a much larger reusable medium lift launcher vehicle named Terran R. The core stage will have a minimum of 8 Aeon R engines. A recent social media post here on March 3rd proudly announced a successful Aeon R test at 100% power, producing a massive 285,000 pounds of thrust. This is a significant development indeed for a vehicle intended for a variety of functions, from satellite launches to that of a space freighter. The new production base for this beast is nicknamed the Wormhole, also located in Long Beach, California. This site was a Boeing C-17 manufacturing plant in a past life. Now it is one of the largest headquarters in the private space industry at a whopping 93 acres. That's over 1 million square feet with 100-foot ceilings to boot, accommodating over 2,000 employees. There's a metallurgical laboratory, handy for tinkering with and developing new metal alloys, powder bed fusion or PBF printers, and dozens of the company's fourth generation Stargate 3D printers. Oh, and there just happens to be a mission control center too, of course. So, as we here at the channel look to the future, Relativity Space won't be stopping at achieving low Earth orbit. With the selected propellant mixture of liquid oxygen or LOX and liquid natural gas for the Aeon engines, they can easily transition to methane on Mars. That's right, Relativity Space have plans to send payloads to the Red Planet, such as Impulse Space's Mars Lander, helping to build humanity's multiplanetary future along with an industrial base. Leading the way to making humanity a multiplanetary species is no easy feat. Just ask SpaceX and their Starship program. Hopefully, the achievements of Relativity Space here will inspire and encourage other companies to contribute their unique talents. Reaching Mars is going to require effort from many companies, not just a select few. Terran 1 is just the start. From all of us here at To The Future, huge congratulations to Tim Ellis and the entire team at Relativity Space. A SpaceX Falcon 9 rocket recently departed from Space Launch Complex 4A or SLC 4A at Cape Canaveral Space Force Station in Florida. With liftoff on Thursday, March 9th, just after 2 p.m. local time, the now 7-time flight-proven booster designated B1073 was hauling 41 web internet communication satellites with a total mass of 6,000 kilograms to orbit. A nominal ascent here as we are so used to seeing, soon followed by stage separation and fairing jettison. As the second stage continued on its journey to the target orbit, the booster was making its way back home. No issues with the boost back and re-entry burns, resulting in the first stage sticking the 103rd consecutive booster recovery back at landing zone 1. Meanwhile, the second stage completed a coast phase that lasted around 55 minutes into flight before a brief engine restart for the second time. Nice to see video of this, as with Starlink for example, we more often than not see the webcast end and rely on social media for the outcome. Of course, the orbital path and loss of signal has everything to do with that. Now, just back to LZ-1 for a moment. With the booster's return, it will undergo refurbishment and modifications as there are plans for it to be repurposed as a side booster for Falcon Heavy. That launch is currently expected to be around May this year. The return to Landing Zone 1 was the 177th successful recovery of a booster. Coming back home here could soon be a thing of the past for missions of this payload class as well, all thanks to a redesign of the second stage booster vacuum nozzle. This means the booster needs to expend more propellant. Returning to LZ-1 will not be available due to low propellant, so a downrange landing on an autonomous drone ship is required. OneWeb is now closing in on the required 600 satellites it needs for global coverage. The mission here boosts the constellation total to 582 out of a planned 648 on orbit satellite. OneWeb looked doomed back in March 2020 and unlikely to finish what was started. You may recall they filed for Chapter 11 bankruptcy followed by a massive layoff for the majority of its workforce. Later that year, the UK government and private sector invested into the establishment of the company to the tune of over $1 billion. With a satellite capable of a 25-year lifespan, this will ensure continued coverage to poor service areas, and hopefully a return on investment. The 1,200 kilometer polar orbit altitude used by OneWeb satellites, however, is well known to be a region dense with space junk, and the distance from the Earth's surface means consumers can expect pretty decent data speeds with low latency. It's a tough market that sees higher minimum speeds and low latency offered by competitors such as SpaceX with their Starlink constellation. It was great to see Mitsubishi Heavy Industries back at the pad on Tuesday, March 7th, ready to go with their new H3 variant rocket after a recent delay. Weather was perfect for launch day as the mission clock entered terminal countdown. With engine ignition, H3 lifted off from Tanegashima Space Center, Japan at 10:37 a.m. local time. Quite an impressive looking vehicle right there as it thundered skyward. Rapidly becoming a tiny dot on its race to space, it was time to jettison those side boosters. Sadly, this was the moment where events took a turn for the worse, and boy, it's always unpleasant to see this. Just after 5.5 minutes into the flight, first stage separation occurred. Usually, this is where the second stage ignition kicks in, of course. However, just 90 seconds later, you notice the telemetry readings here taking a nosedive. Oh man, that's never a good sign. The webcast paused at that time as they tried to understand what was happening. Well, it was not long to wait before it was announced that the self-destruct command was given, obliterating the second stage and its payload. And the entire mission was lost. It is speculated that the second stage engine did not ignite. There are currently no plans to recover any debris for analysis. The H3 rocket itself is a medium lift launch vehicle featuring a two-stage design with the option to attach either 2, 4, or no solid rocket boosters, depending on mission requirements. For this flight, the H3-22 configuration was used, featuring two solid rocket boosters attached to the first stage, with a maximum thrust of 2,158 kilonewtons, or 485,000 pounds of force, and specific impulse of 283.6 seconds, the solid rocket boosters played a critical role in propelling the rocket towards its destination. The first stage of the H3 rocket was powered by two LE9 engines, with liquid hydrogen generating the massive amount of energy needed to lift the rocket off the launch pad. H3 was carrying Japan Aerospace Exploration Agency, or JAXA's Advanced Land Observation Satellite, or ALOS 3. Also known as Daiichi 3, the powerful Earth observation satellite, weighing in at a massive 3,000 kilograms, was to have been placed in a sun-synchronous orbit at an altitude of some 669 kilometers. Equipped with multispectral sensor capability, operating in the visible and near-infrared ranges, it was hoped to provide valuable data and intelligence on marine pollution, volcanic activity, deforestation, earthquakes, and land surface temperature, just as an example, ultimately providing scientists with a wealth of data for years to come. How quickly this whole plan was just flipped on its head just reinforces what we space fans know, that reaching orbit is extremely difficult. So after decades of development to reach this point, it appears that H3 has a road ahead of it in order to prove reliability for future missions. H3 has great potential to fill the gap that exists in the global market for launch capability and even the nation's desire for crewed launch capacity in the future. Well, that's another wrap on an amazing week, and huge congratulations again to Relativity Space. We look forward to bringing you the latest developments in space news next week. Thanks for watching, and remember, onwards to the future.
I just can't hear you. Can't hear you. Sounds like the word effortlessly is not effortless.
Stop complimenting me, it makes me think.
Effortless. See what you've done. Minutes after laugh off. Don't laugh me off.